First, a few words about me. I'm Péter, Czanik from Hungary, Budapest. I'm Syslog-ng evangelist at Balabit. Syslog-ng is upstream developer. I'm doing packaging support and advocacy for Syslog-ng. So let me give you a quick overview what I will talk about today. First of all, a few words about the see-all approach of big data or why and its problems. Next, I would like to talk about our software, Syslog-ng, and a bit more into technical details about message parsing and enriching. And finally, how to save costs using software. And in the rise of GDPR, I want to talk a few words about compliance and anonymization of log messages. So, what is see-all? This is something what I often hear when I talk to big data vendors, that they recommend that all data is important. You should save everything. You never know what will be useful in the future, and you should save it in raw, as you know. You don't know what format you will use in a few years' time, so you should save everything, and you should save in raw. And also, users have this tendency, as at the beginning of their projects, they don't have any idea what data they produce will be useful in the future. This is based on the expectation that storage is practically free, especially compared to the value of data what they have. But is it true? In real life, people quite quickly realize that resources are not free at all. And I don't talk about just small companies here, but I often talk to financial institutes, government agencies, and they also have the same problem. Resources are not really free, especially if you have quality hardware, quality storage, or if you if you use a commercial big data vendor instead of integrating it yourself from open source, you also have to pay for software licenses, so it's not really free. And last week I was in San Francisco for the Red Hat Summit, I talking to many people, I collect these three goals what people have related to big data. First of all, they want to reduce the amount of data, so storage fills up slower, and also to have less data to analyze later on. They also, instead of saving everything in raw, it's much better to save something in a common format, so it's easier to work with that later on. And as much as possible, it's better to do it real time when the data is produced instead of doing large batch processes later on. Syslog-ng is a logging software and can do it for all kinds of log messages, but as I also learned from our users, it's not just log messages what they process with our software, but also many different kind of other text-based data. So first, a few words about logging, as probably not every one of you deal with it directly. It's a recording of events on a computer. Here, my favorite example is from Secure Shell, a login message. Syslog-ng itself is an enhanced logging daemon with a strong focus on portability and central log collection. It has four major roles: collecting, processing, filtering, and storing log messages. The first role is collecting messages. Syslog-ng can collect both system and application logs together, which can provide quite interesting contextual data for either side. It can collect data from a wide variety of sources, platform-specific sources like devlog, journals, sunscreens, whatever. As a central log collection software, it can receive syslog messages over the network using the legacy or the new syslog protocol, and can collect logs or any kind of text data from applications through five sockets, application output, whatever. The next, and in my opinion, the most important role is processing. You can use Syslog-ng to classify, normalize structure logs with built-in parsers. You can also rewrite messages, and you shouldn't think about falsifying messages here, but for example, compliance and anonymization here. You can also enrich data, for example, add geographical information to IP addresses or create additional fields based on the message content. And finally, you can also reformat messages using templates. So you can bring data to the format what is expected by the software processing your data later on. The next role is data filtering, which has two main uses. You can discard surplus log messages, like you don't want to store debug level messages except if there is an emergency and you want to learn what is the problem. And it's also message routing, making sure that the right events reach the right destination. For example, all authentication related messages reach your SIEM system. There are many possibilities based on message content parameters, and there are tons of different filtering functions, and best of all, you can combine any of these using Boolean operators. And finally, you want to store your log messages somewhere. Traditionally, log messages were saved to flat files or sent over network to a central location and saved there to flat files, but there are now many more possibilities. In the past few years, we were working on different big data destinations, Hadoop, MongoDB, Elasticsearch, and Kafka, but there are many other possibilities how to store your log messages. Next, I would like to talk a few words about message formats. As if you take a look at log messages, you will often see the following format: a date, a host name, and some text at the end. This is my favorite SSHD example. You see that the text part is practically a complete English sentence with some variable parts in it, like the username, IP address, port number, and so on. It is designed to be read by humans, but as soon as you want to report on thousands of log messages, you will be quite in trouble, as it's not something what was designed originally for reporting or alerting. The solution for this problem is structured logging. In this case, instead of freeform text, events are represented as name value pairs. For example, coming back to my favorite SSH example, you can say that the application name, username, source IP, and a bunch of other data which can be extracted from the message. The good news is that Syslog-ng has name value pairs inside right from the beginning, as this was like that date, facility, priority, and so on, as name value pairs were necessary for filtering messages or to reformat messages. And parsers within Syslog-ng can turn unstructured and some of the structured data into name value pairs as well. This is important, as if you have freeform text if you have a text message, you cannot really act too much on that one. But if it's turned into name value pairs, you can check the different fields, filter on, for example, on usernames, which are your important users, or store only just a few fields from a longer log message what is really necessary for analysis. For quite a long time, PatternDB was our favorite parser, as most of the messages were in unstructured format, like the SSH login message, and it can extract information from these kind of messages. It can, as it knows the log message itself, it can also add some status fields based on the message text, and also do classification of log messages. The downside of this approach is that it needs an XML database which describes your log messages, so you need to know your messages or your collected data before analyzing them with this parser. Here we can see an example from SSH. The parser can extract the application name, the username, and the source IP from the messages. It, as it knows the log message, it can add name value pairs based on this information that it's a login action and it's actually a failure. And in the end, it can classify the message as a violation. The next parser is JSON, and you might say immediately that yes, it's a structured message. But as long as we don't parse it from the collection point of view, it's a long string. So you have to parse it to have the advantages of using name value pairs. We also have a parser called CSV parser. It's for columnar data, so it's not just CSV files, but whatever data you have as columnar data, like an Apache access log. And in this example, you can see many fields extracted from an access log. And at the bottom of the screen, you can see that one of the extracted fields, the username, is used in the file name where data is saved. The next one is the key value parser, which can find key value pairs in log messages. This is typical in firewall messages, like this one. Is from IP tables, but most other firewalls use similar log format as well. There are many other parsers inside Syslog-ng. Here is just a quick overview. XML parser for basic XML-based messages. The Linux audit parser, which is getting more and more important. The date parser, many applications have pretty interesting thoughts how date should look like, nothing standard, but if you have templates, then Syslog-ng can parse these strange data formats and extract the date, time, whatever. And the Syslog-ng configuration library has also a number of parsers. Actually, these are built from different parsers we already discussed, like the Cisco parser for syslog-like messages from Cisco routers or switches, the Apache parser, which can also parse the date format embedded in the Apache log messages, and so on. And if none of these suits your need, you can write your own parser in Python as well. Using this, you can parse complex data formats. We use it, for example, to extract medical records in some US projects. It can also be used to involve some external data sources. Of course, it's slower than C, the original programming language was Syslog-ng. On the other hand, it's much more easy to develop, and it doesn't need a special environment. You can also enrich log messages and add additional name value pairs based on the message content. We already discussed ButtonDB. Using GIP, you can add location geolocation to your to IP addresses, which is quite interesting if you want to detect anomalies or display locations on a map. And we can use also CSV files to add metadata to log messages, for example, a host role or contact person or any other kind of information which can come handy. And this way, you can create much more accurate alerts or dashboards later on. Let's get back for a few moments to the goals I mentioned at the beginning. Reduce the amount of data, bring data to a common format, and process messages as much as possible in real time. How you are doing it with Syslog-ng? Parsing and enrichment can turn your data into information, which is easier to act on. It can facilitate filtering quite a lot. Reformatting can help you to bring your data into a common format like JSON or other formats you want, and make your data ready for processing. And filtering can reduce your the amount of data saved to your big data destination quite considerably. And all of this is done real time with a single application. I mentioned GDPR, but there are also quite a few other compliance requirements about what data can or cannot appear in log messages, for example, PCI DSS about credit card numbers, GDPR about personal data like IP addresses, usernames, and so on. Locating sensitive information can be done in multiple ways. You can use regular expressions for example, for credit card numbers, which is quite slow, but it and resource intensive. On the other hand, it has the advantage that it also works on unknown logs. You don't have to know your log format before analyzing it. ButtonDB, using ButtonDB or the CSV parser to locate sensitive data is much faster and efficient. On the other hand, you need to know your message format beforehand. Anonymizing messages can be done in multiple ways. If it's nothing really important later on, you can simply overwrite the sensitive part with a constant. But if you actually want to use the data to analyze sessions in your web server logs or whatever, then you also can replace the original sensitive data with a hash of the original. So the same username will be encrypted to the same hash all the time, so you can follow sessions in your data. On the other hand, you don't know the exact username, so this is good for analysis and also good for privacy. So, few words about what's new in Syslog-ng in recent releases. We added disk-based buffering. So even if the sender machine is down, you can collect your messages. I mentioned the Python parser worked quite a lot on the Elasticsearch destination, added HTTP. So for example, Splunk uses it recently for collecting data. And we had quite a lot of performance and memory usage improvements. So let me go through the benefits of using Syslog-ng for message processing. First of all, it's high performance and reliable log-end data collection. It's also a simplified architecture, as you can use a single application both for system and application data. Thanks to parsing and formatting, it's easier to use data, and due to filtering, it's also a lower load on your big data destinations. If you became interested in Syslog-ng, our main website is syslogng.org, which will actually forward you to a new website, but this is easier to remember than that one. Our source code is on GitHub, which also hosts our issue tracking system, and we have quite good mailing list and also Twitter if you want to chat instead of writing emails. Do you have any questions?
Do you have any questions, guys? No questions, then please applause for Péter. And actually, I have a question, because you mentioned how Syslog-ng is working. You mentioned what the benefits are of Syslog-ng, but what do you think, who are the target groups that could the best use Syslog-ng?
Actually, this is mostly used by system administrators. Those are our main users. But when I was last week in San Francisco, there were many data scientists who came to us, actually, that yes, we are collecting data from many sources. We have an abundance of data, which is just too much, and we need something to collect this data and make sure that only relevant data stays. So while it's originally sysadmin tool, but it's becoming more widespread, not just for system messages, but also for many kinds of data.
Okay, thank you very much for your presentation.